Hi everyone, Susumi here. I'm talking about how to find shapes in the Foldit Electron Density Cloud, and we are looking at puzzle number 1152. Just a quick review of the Electron Density menu settings. I've got my threshold set right above the M in the word mouse, and I've got my alpha, which is transparency, set a little bit to the right of center. And I was most recently looking at backbone shapes, so I was using the solid cloud, but I'm going to look for side chains now, and I'm going to switch to wireframe. I just find they show up better in the wireframe view. Now we've got way too much cloud on the screen, it just looks like a big blob, so I want to zoom into the middle of the cloud. I have put my protein right through the middle of the cloud, and that's what's going to give us visibility in the middle. I'm going to put my mouse on the backbone and hit Shift Q. That's going to zoom us in. And I have found some sheets in this cloud, and I marked the endpoints of the sheets with red. There's a sheet right here going up and down, and that's the first place that I'm going to look for side chains. I've got the protein near the sheet. I've zoomed in, and I'm going to cut away. Actually, I'm looking at the front of the sheet right now, and the side chains are facing towards me and away from me, which makes them hard to see. So I'm going to turn this 90 degrees so that I'm looking at the sheet in silhouette. Okay, I'm going to cut away some of the foreground and background. There's still too much cloud on the screen for me to see things clearly. To cut away the foreground, I'm going to use Control-Alt-Drag with the mouse. And to cut away the background, I'm going to use Control-Shift-Drag. And I can see this sheet clearly now, running from the red dot to the other red dot, going up and down. It's kind of zigzaggy shaped. And the side chains are going off to the left and the right. When I'm looking for side chains to use as landmarks, I always try to find the large ones with the rings on them, the large orange side chains with rings. They're called aromatics. And those make the best landmarks. Not every protein has those. This protein happens to have a lot of them. And I can see the side chain going off to the left here has a large head on it. It's kind of a wedge-shaped head. It's got a skinny neck where it attaches to the backbone. This wedge-shaped head is going to be the kind of side chain that has two rings together, a little ring here and a big ring there. And I'm just going to mark that with a purple dot so that I can find it later. Moving down the sheet, we've got another side chain on the right here that has a big round head, a narrow neck, and it attaches to the backbone. I'm going to mark that with a purple dot. And I noticed that this round head does not have a tip on it. That's important for figuring out what kind of side chain it is. Moving a little further down the sheet, I've got a Y-shaped side chain. It's a short one. And I'm going to mark that with a green dot. First, I put a purple dot by hitting Tab. Now the purple dot's hard to see because it's in the foreground and I cut away so much foreground. So I'm just going to roll that piece of the protein back a little bit in, towards the back of the screen, and then my dot becomes visible. Put my mouse on the dot, right click, and I can choose a new color for the dot. Okay. And then moving up the sheet, the next side chain is just a peg. It doesn't have a head at all. Okay, I'm going to mark that one with a green dot as well. And I accidentally marked the wrong spot. Okay, I'm going to hit Tab again on that dot. There's a little green recycle bin here on the point information menu that'll get rid of the dot. And let me see if I can put my dot on that peg. There we go. And right click to choose the color. Okay, so I've got two purple dots and two green dots. Those are marking side chains on this one sheet. And I'm going to flip now over to a text document that I use when I'm working on an electron density puzzle. I went to the puzzle page on the website and I got the sequence. That's the list of letters that stand for the amino acids in the protein. And since this is a long protein, I broke that sequence up into two lines and I put it in my text document. Then above the sequence, I typed in the segment numbers going from 1 all the way to 199. And those are going to help me find things in the protein. Then below the sequence, I typed in the secondary structure that was predicted on the protein. When we were given the protein, it had helixes and sheets already predicted on it. These dashes are loops. The H's are helix segments, and the E's are sheets. And again, I got those off the protein in the puzzle. Then I made some notes down at the bottom about the kind of side chains that I'm looking for as landmarks. The double ring side chain is abbreviated with a W, and I got these letters off of the wiki. The big single ring without a tip on it is abbreviated with an F. So I'm going to look for a spot where there's a W and an F next to each other in the sequence. They might go WF, they might go FW, because we're not sure which direction that sheet was facing. Okay, and it turns out in this protein there's only one place where a W and an F occur next to each other. It's right here, and that happens to be in the middle of a sheet, which is good because that's what we were looking at. And the W is segment number 151. So we're going to go find segment number 151 and move it into the cloud in that exact spot and see if we can get the W and F side chains to match up with their spots in the cloud. Okay, I'm going to turn this back 90 degrees. I happen to have this lined up so that segment 151 is right here. I'm going to hit tab on it. It's a tryptophan, which is what's abbreviated with a W. You can see it's a double ring. And let's see if we can rotate. Its neighbor right here is the large single ring. Okay, I'm going to move those into the cloud. If you're ever trying to use the move tool in an electron density puzzle and you can't see the move tool, it might be because the move tool lives in the foreground. And if you have cut away much of the foreground, your move tool might not be visible. If that's the case, you can increase the foreground visibility until that move tool reappears. Okay, we're going to slide that into the cloud and put the focus on it and hit Shift Q. I'm going to turn it so we can see the side chains again, and we're going to cut away some foreground using Control-Alt-Drag. Cut away some background using Control-Shift-Drag. Okay, I've actually got another sheet here in front of the sheet I want to look at, so I'm going to try changing the focus of the camera. Put my cursor right on the part that's in the middle of the sheet and hit Shift-Q again. Changes the zoom. And let's cut away some foreground, Control-Alt-Drag. Cut away some background, Control-Shift-Drag. There we go. Now I'm looking at the sheet I want to see, the one with the dots on it. Okay, I want the double ring to be on the left, single ring on the right, and I want the double ring to be above the single ring. Let's see if we can move the protein that way. Okay, I lost my move tool. I'm going to increase foreground visibility with Control-Alt-Drag until I can see the move tool. Let's see if we got this the right way. Lost my move tool again. That's frustrating. And I've got the double ring on the bottom and the single ring on the top. That's the opposite of what I want, so I'm going to flip this around. There we go. Okay, and I'm going to check it from 90 degrees. Get it lined up a little better with the backbone. Flip back 90 degrees. See if I can get those side chains right in their pockets. Okay, I've got the big ring in its pocket. The little Y down here is almost in its pocket. I need to move down a little bit. Okay, that's lined up pretty well. Now this double ring up here is flipped the wrong way. I'm just going to give that a tug, and it'll flip down into the right position. And then the fourth one we found is this little peg up here, and it's in its pocket. So I've got those lined up pretty well. I'm going to put bands on those. I like to put a band at the first corner in the side chain. When I place a band, I like to use the Alt key in addition to Shift mouse. The Alt key keeps the band from sticking to any other part of the protein. Oops. I'm banding all four of the ones that I placed in the cloud. The bands at this point are just acting as markers for me, so I know that I've placed those side chains where I want them. Once I've placed as much of the protein in the cloud as I can, before I start my first wiggle, I'm going to increase the strength on those bands to 10, and that's going to help hold the protein in the cloud during those first wiggles and shakes when it's getting settled. Okay, I've got my bands marking my side chains. I'm going to get rid of these dots now so that when I make new purple and green dots elsewhere, I don't get mixed up about which ones I'm currently working with. Now I notice as I move down the sheet that there is another large ring side chain down here at the bottom, and this one has a tip on it. So I definitely want to find the place in the cloud where that large side chain is going to fit. I'm just going to increase the foreground visibility a bit so I can see more cloud. And I can see that right now the side chain is pointing off into an empty space. There's no cloud there. Let me spin this around. And there it is. I see the pocket. Here's the wide part. Here's the neck. You can see the neck connecting to the backbone. And this one has a really big tip on it. In fact, the tip on this is so long that it seems to be intersecting with another part of the protein. I'm just going to bump the threshold up a little bit and make sure that that detaches when there's a higher threshold. There we go. Now the tip has detached, and we have a nice view of the ring and the tip on that side chain. So I definitely want to fit that side chain in there. And I notice that the backbone coming off of that side chain is curled. It looks like a little bit of helix there. So I'm going to make a helix to fit in there. I'm going to cut the backbone, give myself, I don't know, four segments, and we'll change that to helix. And curl it up. Okay, and I want to fit that into this piece of cloud. Now I could have banded the side chain to there and used rebuild, but in this case, since it looked like helix, I decided to go ahead and make a helix to fit in there. Okay, I've got that side chain fit in pretty well. I've got the backbone fitting into the curl. It's important to fit your side chains into the cloud as well as you can. If you just get the backbone in the cloud and you don't get the side chains onto the right side, you're going to suffer in your density scores. If you want to get the really high density scores on the segments, you need to get the side chains into their pockets in the cloud. Okay, I'm going to band that. And then in order to see more backbone, I would have to lower the threshold again. But that's a look at how we do the side chains. Use them as landmarks to tell you where the backbone needs to go. And in the next video, we will look at how to find helixes. And thanks everyone for watching.